My name is Lenny Schwartz. I'm Saul's brother. And Saul is my brother. And he's a nice kid. He's all right. Take him to the movies when he was a kid. And we've become pretty good friends. And eventually he became a runner. Cross country runner. And every time he ran cross country, he would get lost. And we had to send the police out for him. And the police took their dogs with them. And after a while, the dogs quit the job. He was fed up with them. Every week, this guy would get lost, you know. And the dogs retired. And that was the end of his running. And he went to school. And he studied. He was very ambitious. He was the only one to finish college in our family. And it paid off. He became a success in life. And I love him. And keep taking care of yourself, you know. And what's next? My grandparents or what? On my mother's side, we used to visit our grandparents maybe every week. They lived on the east side. And these two are some people. They came over from Russia. And my grandfather, he was a big man, and he bought a route for seltzer. Delivering seltzer in a horse and wagon. And he would carry those things of seltzer up on the fifth floor, all over, you know. And he wouldn't even tell a horse where to go. The horse knew where to go and where to stop and so on and so forth. And my grandma, tough little old lady, she opened a fish market underneath the Brooklyn Bridge. And those two made a living that way. And the family used to get together like on a weekend. And they would play cards for pennies. They would play cards and we would spend the night down here. We'd sleep over. And it was nice, you know, we get to do these things. And when I was overseas, my grandfather and my uncle, which was his son, they went to, and another aunt of mine went to Atlantic City. Somebody was getting married, and I don't think my grandfather was ever in the train. And it was a bad accident. And they all got killed. They couldn't even identify the bodies. I didn't know that because I was overseas. I found out when I came home. And it was an awful thing, you know. But I was looking forward to seeing him. But he was a nice man. Nice family.
Do you remember their names?
Geez, you know, my uncle, who got killed there, his name was, what was his name? I knew it was his brother, but he didn't go on that trip. The other brother went. Gee, I can't think of his name. Anyway, I knew he was in the Navy in 1922. He was on a destroyer. What's his name? Louis! His name was Louis. And telling us about the Navy. Those days they shoveled coal into the engine, no oil or anything. That's how they got the name the Black Gang. You know, they used to say, what are you on, deck force? No, I'm in a Black Gang. They used to get dirty from the coal, shoveling the coal in there, you know. And then, of course, you know, became motorized.
What do you remember about your parents? Their names?
My parents were beautiful people. My papa's a hard worker man, and my mom was a terrific cook. Never a bottom on one of those pots. There was always more in there. Whoever would come over would eat. And they were beautiful people. My mother died, she was only 49 years old. She had the Hodgkin's disease, and I was there when she died. And her last words were, she called me Leonard. Leonard, go home and play with the baby. That was Marilyn. And that was it. And she closed her eyes and she passed away. And my pop, he lived 10 years after that. 10 years. He lived with us, so we lived with him, whatever it was, you know. And then that was it.
Where'd you grow up?
We grew up in the Bronx. In the Bronx. I think when I was a little kid, we lived in Harlem. But then we moved to the Bronx. Those days the toilet was in the hall, you know. In the hall, you didn't have a toilet in your apartment. Unless those are the rooms my parents picked out, I don't know. But, yeah. That's about it with those people. I know very nice people. Then on my father's side, he had quite a few brothers there. He was the only one, I think, who didn't finish school. One was a lawyer, he became a judge. And one was, they call them dental mechanics those days. People who make false teeth. That was his profession. And one was a pharmacist. One was a furrier. And the sister was a teacher. So they all had something to do anyway. And they're very nice. Nice people, you know, hard-working people. Oh, I think my grandfather was a tailor. I think he was a tailor.
Do you remember their names?
Grandma's name was Goldie. I don't know the father's name. It was Sam, I think. I don't know. I don't remember the name.
They lived in the Bronx or the...
They lived in the Bronx. Okay. And... yeah, they lived in the Bronx. And I was with them. And,
do you know how your parents met?
No. Good people. During the Depression, my dad was working. And he got me a job down where he worked. Those days when you went to work 8 o'clock in the morning and you get done and the boss told you you're done. And the ladies, you know, it was tough. And you worked all hours. And that was it. It didn't make much money, but way of living was a different way altogether. It wasn't like it is today, you know.
What do you remember as about your childhood when you and Charlie and Reba and Saul were small kids?
Well, my brother Charlie, he played baseball for his junior high, and I hung around with a bunch of kids who, whatever the season was, we played ball, baseball, football. Drugs, forget about it. Nobody knew about drugs those days. We played ball. And at night, there was a shoe store there. They repaired shoes, Klein's. And the people used to stand in the window fixing shoes. And we used to watch these guys. And we used to laugh because they used to take nails and throw in their mouth. And one other time, they take it out and bang it into the shoe, you know. Wondering if they ever swallowed them, you know. Thought, what was that? Nails. And we used to play football right near there at night, and we didn't have a football, so we had to get a cardboard box, roll it up and tie it with a piece of rope, and that was our football. We played football. And if you're playing stickball, there's one car on a whole block. One car, and a cop would come and break your stick because we may break a window. He puts the stick in the sewer and he breaks it, you know, breaks it up and throws it in the sewer. Aww. And that's what they used to do. They used to come around in a police car. was funny.
How did you spend your holidays, Christmas?
No special way. Holidays on a Jewish holiday. If I was downtown, my grandfather would talk me into going to the synagogue with him, you know. But I told him, of course, I'm a quarter. And he came across with the quarter. You don't know what they're saying, you know. Everything's in Hebrew, and it's really boring, you know.
Did you practice any of the Jewish traditions when you grew up?
I was bar mitzvahed. Joyfully and trembling I stand before you. Today I am a man. The rest forget about that.
Did your parents practice any of their traditions?
Not really. We had Passover, we had the matzah and that stuff, you know, but they weren't real fanatics at it, you know. It's do what you want, you know, what the hell.
When did they learn English, or was it before?
What did you say?
When did the family begin speaking English?
As far as I know, they always spoke English. Mm-hmm. You know, broken English things. When they would go downtown, that seltzer man, though, he was something, that guy. He got killed in a train wreck, you need that. Put the seltzer on his shoulder. You never see these bottles of seltzer there? Shh! You gonna, what do you call them? He used to deliver them on his shoulder, 12 at a time. They're heavy. The horse will weigh them. The horse, you don't have to tell him anything. The horse goes and gets to a house and he stops.
Did you ride with them?
No, but my cousin did. I have a cousin that lives in Brooklyn that he rode with them. He was telling me about the horse. I didn't know about it. He said the horse would stop. I forgot the horse's name.
What was your cousin's name?
Felix. We call him Pete. He was in the army with his two brothers, and one brother would be my age. He got killed on Leyte. And I didn't know about it until I come back from him. Because when we were downtown, our cousins, we used to hang out with the ones that were our age, you know? Like my brother hung out with his brother, he was older, and I hung around with the Bobby, and yeah, poor guy got killed. He shouldn't have been in the army. He's always a sick kid, you know. But he was coming late.
So how far in school did you go?
I only went to third grade. And I stopped going because I couldn't remember a damn thing they were teaching me. You know, every time I would do homework or something, I would turn back the pages, look for this guy's name and that guy's name, and I couldn't remember, so I wasted my time anyway, so I didn't. But when I stopped going to school, I went right to work. I got a job.
Third grade?
I got a job for a dress manufacturer, the shipping clerk there. And I worked out, you know. I think you made 12, 15 bucks a week then, but hey, you go in and get breakfast for a dime. Juice, coffee, and a donut for a dime those days, and Needix. You go to the automat where they had the coffee, and you know, you put the money in the, and you got doors there. That's the automat, and coffee was a nickel, delicious coffee. Vegetables was a nickel. You know, so whatever you made, you manage. Subway was a nickel. The news was 2 cents.
What year was this?
I'm saying?
What year was this?
In the 30s, 37, 38, 39, and in 40 I went into service. So I couldn't work those hours anymore. You know, you'd meet my girl and you get done 10, 11 o'clock at night. No overtime. They didn't pay you overtime.
You
had a job.
What did Charlie do while you were working there?
Charlie worked for He worked in the same line that I was in, but for a different company. He was a shipping clerk too. Two different companies. The owners were the same, but two different names on the companies, you know, and two different buildings, so we weren't together at all, you know. And my father was a buyer. He used to buy all the fabrics. It was a dress factory. He would buy all the fabrics so they make them into dresses, you know.
In the garment district?
Yeah.
So, did you meet Lily before you went into the service or after?
Before I went into the service, I'm not lying.
How old were you guys?
I went into service, I was 21. I went in September. In September, I was 21, so I went into service when I was 21.
How did you and Lily meet?
Well, I'm going to tell you something about me and Lily. I used to live on a first floor, second floor, and I'd sit by the window. Right opposite my house was a World War I cemetery, Civil War cemetery. And I used to look out the window. Then I see a girl riding a bike. Beautiful girl riding a bike with a sweater and a skirt. And I've seen this girl around the neighborhood, you know, but I never know, you know, I used to see her. Always attracted my attention. She was always dressed so nice. And I said, when I saw her, I said to myself, Lenny, you're going to marry her. Honestly, God. You're going to marry her. She's got beautiful legs, you know, and everything was beautiful about her. And one day, she lived right across the street from Bronx Park. So outside of Bronx Park, they had benches. And right opposite our house, there was benches. That's where the park was, you know, with a big fence. So I came home one night, I sat by the bench, one of the benches. I was getting some fresh air because I was in a factory all day. It was late at night, 11, 12 o'clock at night. Then all of a sudden I see her coming out of a building. So where did she go? About 50 feet away there's another bench, so she sits down on the bench over there. So nothing happened. She's sitting there, I'm sitting here, and all of a sudden the car stops with three guys in it. And they try to pick her up, you know. So she runs over to me, the hero, you know, three guys. And we started talking and all that, and they took off. And that was it. The hell of a way to meet her. Stopped her from getting raped or something. Oh, gee. And she didn't have a mother. Her mother died when she was 10 years old. She was living with her aunt and her cousin. And I hated those people. They treated her so bad. Used to hide food from her. And her father was paying them to take care of her, you know. And I hated them. And the her cousin was a little fat kid, one of these geniuses, you know. And as a matter of fact, I haven't seen him in many, many years. And maybe about 10 years ago, I get a call. It's from him. I don't know how he traced me down, you know. And he says, you know, I'm downstairs, could I come up to see you? I says, no, keep going. He used to hide food on her, that's something. A little fat kid, he became a genius or something, I don't know.
What was their names?
I says, keep going, what was it? Gee, I don't remember the name.
What was Lily's maiden name?
Lily, what was her name? Her real name was Libby. L-I-B-E, but she called herself Lily. Her name was Lebowitz. L-E-B-O-W-I-T-Z, Lebowitz. And the father was in the army in Where was he from? Russia, I guess. I don't know. A nice man. Nice man.
Did Lily
have... He used to come over here. And he always brought me cigars. I smoked cigars. Smoked cigars, chewed tobacco, everything. A pipe, everything but cigarettes.
Your grandparents were from Poland?
Poland? You know, I don't know where he was from. I thought he was from Russia. I don't know. Okay. The guy still had army training. He walked so straight, you know?
So you and Lily met, and then you right after that, you went... You didn't get married until after you were in the service, right?
Yeah, when I came home on leave.
So how did you tell us about from going from work to joining the Coast Guard? How did all that happen?
Well, I was disgusted with the job, getting up and working all those hours. And on the other hand, I wanted to see if I could take care of myself, go in the service and see what happens, you know. And I went down to join the Navy. They wanted a 4-year hitch. I said, well, I'm in no rush. The Marines, I don't want the Marines. Let me try the Coast Guard. I go down to the Coast Guard with a 3-year hitch. So I figured, hey, why spend 4 years if I don't like it? Let me just spend 3 years, you know? Once you're in, you can't get out. So I enlisted in the Coast Guard, and you know how long I was in? 5 years. The war was on. I was overseas most of the time, in the Pacific. And I was in the fight. So what the hell, you know?
When did you go in?
September. I went in September. My birthday was in September. I went in September. And I...
What year?
When I was going to a boot camp. Ellis Island, you know? I was on a ferry. And there's another guy there. He was going over to Ellis Island too. And he was going to boot camp too. And we became friends right then and there, you know. And went to boot camp. And we became friends. As a matter of fact, when he died, his wife called me up and told me, you know, he was sending Christmas cards and stuff like that, you know. Alan, oh, what a nice guy. So we were in boot camp, and they had boxing one night. Guy gets up there, boats amazed. Whatever his name is, Joe Blow is 199 pounds. He'll fight anybody. Who's gonna fight him? You know, you gotta be crazy. A lumberjack from Maine someplace. So I says to Al, we were sitting there. I says, I'm going to fight this guy. He says, what, are you crazy? Look at the size of him. He's got 50 pounds on him. I said, I'm going to knock the crap out of him. And what happens? I go out and fight the guy. Only for one reason. My name was Schwartz. And if they see I can knock the crap out of this guy, no one's going to make any remarks about my name. Because the Jewish kind of service wasn't the best thing, anyway, you know. And that's what happened. But they gave it a draw. Too long they gave it a draw, but everybody knows I won. So here's another incident. This you got. When I got finished with the Mohawk, we got on the Liggett. So on the Liggett, me and I was sitting one another on about the third deck. And they had boxing there. The New Zealanders were aboard. We fight New Zealanders and the Marines. Everybody was aboard the ship. So, okay, welterweights. Who wants to fight welterweights? So I'm sitting with Al and he don't say anything. Then we see a guy coming from the stern of the ship walking toward the ring. He says, Lenny, look at this guy, skinny guy. Knock the shit out of him. Go ahead, you know. So I said, okay, I volunteered. So I go down, walking down two decks. When I get down near the ring, the guy isn't there. The guy was walking to the head. He was going to the bathroom. And here comes a guy from the back. The guy, every inch of him was muscle. He was from the black gang, you know, down below. Oh, then I look up at Al. He's up on the top deck, and I'm looking up at him, and he's hysterical. He's laughing his ass off. He's laughing. And it was a good fight. They gave it a draw, too. I think the guy won, though. I think the guy was a good fighter, you know. I didn't know about fighting. I went out and fought. And I'll never forget that. He laughed and laughed, and he was such a nice guy.
So what happened from, let's see, tell us a little bit about Ellis Island and then about your first assignment.
Ellis Island was all right. It was a boot camp. It was nice. It wasn't like the Marines. You're going, you know, jumping over mountains and all that stuff. It's a different section altogether. You do rescue work, you know. You had to have the knots, how to tie knots, and the splicing and signaling and all that stuff. That you learn on the cutout, the signal with the flags, Morse code you had to know. And that was on the cutting, you had to learn there. But the boot camp was nice. Boot camp was nice. And then I got to the station to a Coast Guard cutter. And Cal was stationed with me on the cutter, and we got to the cutter. About 6-7 guys from different ships in the boot camp. And the guy comes over, boats are made, he was half drunk. And turned me off right away. He says, the guy says, this is the Mohawk, 165-foot Coast Guard cutter. The guy just came aboard. We have no bunks for you. We have no lockers for you. You're going to live out of a sea bag. Try living out of a sea bag. Everybody got to dig everything out. You're going to live out of a sea bag, and at night you're going to swing a hammock. Right then I want to run away. A hammock. You ever sleep in a hammock? The worst thing in the world. We had one guy going to jump over the side. They tied the hammock to him. They tied him to the hammock, and they put a bucket on the side. You get so seasick on these cutters, you know. They're wide, so instead of pitching, they go from side to side. And look, here we are, you get sick on it, you know. And that was it for that ship, the cutter. We'd stay there for a while, and the food would... And the only thing that I really complained about was no foul weather gear. You're standing in the crow's nest in the rain, you're wearing your pea coat. You got a bow lookout, you're right at the bow, right at the tip of the hip with your pea coat on. And when you go ashore, you have to pass inspection, you know, with your pea coat. No foul weather gear. I used to complain about that. You see these guys with on other ships with nice jackets, you know? I don't know why they never did that. And we would go at 2 o'clock in the morning. Man overboard, you know, a drill. So every night before you go to sleep, you take a look at where's your station in the lifeboat. One port side, two port side, whatever side, you know. And when the alarm goes off, they lower the boat, you get in the boat, and you start rowing. Throws a life jacket over the side, and that's the man overboard, how long it takes you to... Then when you get back to the ship, you have to climb up lines to get back on the ship. And, but those drills came in handy, you know, a lot of drills came in handy. I got pictures of some players. They have a ship that we saved the crew of that. I'll see if I could find it later. We saved the crew, and we start towing it in. And as it was, it had a very bad list on it. It was going to England. a load of pig iron on it. England was at war at the time, and they needed this stuff, smelt it down for guns and stuff like that. And hit bad sea, and this ship was loaded fast. They wanted to get it going fast, and the load shifted to one side. Steel and stuff like that. And the ship had a very bad list. So we were towing it. I don't know where we were towing it to, but we were towing it, and all of a sudden, train's upside down. They got the crew off already. It wasn't easy. These guys had to climb up. The ship was sideways. They had to climb it up and get the guys off. And I know they all came back wet. And we got the guys off there, and we had to cut the lines. The tow lines, towing the ship. Because if that ship went down, she would pull us down. So we cut the lines with axes. We chopped up after deck. And that was it. We left the ship there. Whatever happened to it? Some ship probably would go into it at night. Who knows, you know? And, they got to put buoys around it.
What was your responsibility on the Mohawk?
Just a seaman, deck force. Lower boats, anything that's on top. Lower boats, man the guns, and whatever guns we had on here. We didn't have any guns on here. And scrub the decks, keep the ship clean. And that's it. That's what a seaman does.
It seems like there was pictures of you cleaning guns. Was that on the Mohawk or a different ship?
No, that was on the Lincoln. I became a gunner's mate.
Okay. So how long were you on the Mohawk?
Oh, I don't know. We got transferred off to the Hunter Liggett. We went to Brooklyn Navy Yard. They told us, you can't sleep on this ship. Go down to the seaman house. By the waterfront, by the fish market, there was a seaman house that lets you sleep there. Ship had bed bugs and roaches and everything on it. And they had to fumigate the ship before we got on there. So, I used to sleep over the seaman's house.
Were you courting Lily at the time?
Yeah.
Writing letters?
No, I was in Brooklyn Navy Yard. I used to... Or when I was in boot camp, she would come out on weekends and visit me. But she couldn't go ashore for a couple of weeks, you know, before you were...
So after... after they fixed the Liggett up, What year was that, and where did you sail first, and what were you responsible
for? After they fixed the Liggett up, we started getting landing boats on. You know these davits that hold up the lifeboats? They had to get different ones on, because these are motor boats. They're heavier boats, you know, the Higgins boats. That's what we use on the landings. Higgins was making boats in the street. It was such a good idea, these Higgins boats, you know, and that's what they put me in one. At Guadalcanal, I ran a Higgins boat, and I was on the first wave to hit the beach, and they were good little boats.
So they loaded the boats on, and then where did you sail first?
Well, we were training them. First, we were training them. Like off North Carolina or Cherry Point or someplace like that where it's rough. And to land, get them in there, get them off, pick them up later on, you know. Get them to practice how to jump off these boats because, you know, half the times you can't go all the way in, you know. You run on the ground, you know. So these guys have to jump off in the water and they got these heavy packs on. So you have to train them and, that's what we did. We trained the Marines, and then we were going, eventually we were going overseas, but we didn't know where we were going. We left, and we saw we were going through the Panama Canal, we knew we were going to the Pacific, right? So, Then we hit some islands before we got to where we were going, to New Zealand. We hit some islands. We didn't know where we were going to. Nobody tells you anything. And we had crummy islands, Tonga, Tabu, the Hebrides, New Caledonia. Crappy islands, you know, it's nothing there. And you see a guy go up a tree barefooted, get coconuts dying, you know. And, then we wound up in New Zealand, we were training troops. That's where the invasion took place. We got the troops out of New Zealand, the Marines were there. You know, we brought Marines over and trained them. And then the big night was Guadalcanal. First invasion against the Japs. The invasion wasn't too bad, but the planes intercepted us and we shot down four planes. We got all this old fire, you might hit another ship. Guys I was with were wiped up anyway, and they start shooting. We knocked down four planes, direct hits, boom, boom, boom. So no one said anything, no complaints. But there was a time when I was on a gun captain on a 3-inch gun. And there was no bombers there, but the Zeros. Zeros are the fighting planes, you know. One seat or two seats in them, I don't know. And we got orders, do not fire, do not fire, you may hit another ship. Do not fire. And here comes a Zero right at us, a 3-inch gun. There's about seven guys there, you know. And I got the phones on, I was the gun captain. Usually the gunner's mate is. Because anything goes wrong with the gun, it's up to me to fix it, you know. So, do not fire, do not fire. And here comes a Zero right in at us. Coming right in at us. One guy yells out, Gunny, let me shoot, let me shoot. Don't shoot, he said, don't fire, don't fire. Don't shoot, I'm gonna shoot, don't shoot. I'm taking the gun to shoot. My ears were being in a sling, you know? No one listened to me. And here comes this plane right at us. It's not shooting at us or anything. Right over our head. And it kept going. Now the other thing we could figure out, she was having dog fights up there with our planes. She must have been out of ammo, but she could have wiped out the whole gun, the whole seven guys with no problem. You know, one machine gun burst, you know. And they kept going with us. I said, unload that gun, get that shell out of there. See that picture on the left? It's a 5-inch gun. We competed with the Navy. That was gun captain on that gun. Right? In the Navy, 10 ships with the same type gun. So I was gun captain I went over to meet the crew. I says, who's the pointer, who's the trainer? Pointer and trainer, pointer. Turns the gun one direction and the trainer up and down. The one guy tries to get it on air, one guy tries to get where they hit it, you know. So when they say mark, mark, that means they're both on the target. Then it's up to the gunner's mate to tell him to fire, you know. But here's what I had to do before that. I said, who's the pointer, who's the trainer? I'm the pointer, I'm the trainer. I said, don't forget, when I hear mark, mark, I'm going to shoot. He says, okay, okay. I'll give you a mark, mark. Those are the guns that are really pointing the gun, you know. And, who's the breech man? I'm the breech man. Then I went down the line. It's the positions, you know. I said, okay, breech man, open breech. Breech open. What do you see? Bore clear. That means the bore is clear because when you shoot a powder bag off, you know, you put the shell in a powder bag. The powder bag is dipped in ether. And that burns fast, but if it don't burn out, you throw another bag in, it's going to blow up. Everybody's going to get killed, you know. So, okay, shell man, I want a regular shell. I don't want a red one. I don't want a black one. Red one is armor-piercing. No, black is armor-piercing. Red is tracer. I said I want a regular shell because we're going after a target, a moving target. A wood moving target. That's the shell I want. Okay, put the shell in. What kind of shell you got? Regular shell. Seated. He pushes it in as far as he could with his hand. Where's the ramrod? Ramrod's here. Get that shell in there, seated good. Then they push it all the way in, and it gets seated on the Lancer groove, Lancer groove, that's the rifling. Gets seated there, you know. Because, you know, when that shell goes off, it spins. You could hear him. I heard him coming at me, too. You could hear him coming at you, because the guy up on the hill used to shoot them at him. And, yeah, he rammed it in. His shell is seated. Closed breech. All right, Peach Man, what are you doing? Breech is closed, but what are you going to do? He's going to put a primer in. Put the primer in, it's like a blank. That's what hits the powder bag. The powder bag explodes and the shell comes out, you know? And, okay, I'm waiting for the mark, both of them. They were following that all the time. They were loading the gun. Mark, fire! And all the guys said, then we go through the same thing again, you know, load it and all that. And the guy up on the fire control, hey, Gunner! That was me, I had the phone on. What a direct hit, beautiful! He said, you're the only guy that hit anything. He's watching through the binoculars and all that, he's watching that, you know, with radar and all that. And we hit 10 of them. We raided the Navy E. On some of my uniforms, you see the Navy E. Right over here. Efficiency and gunnery. That was nice. I think we got $2 more a month. That was nice.
So
we were the heroes.
What was the life aboard the Liggett like?
The what?
What was the life aboard the Liggett like? Your life, what did you do, and where did you sleep, and when you're on the...
Oh, yeah. You had the guys in charge of you, they had things to do. Deck Force always had stuff to work, scrubbing or scraping rust or going over the side and scraping barnacles or something, you know. They always found stuff for you to do, or clean up the deck, and there's always stuff to do. Don't forget the guys down below, the guys who did the welding and all that, they always had stuff to do.
Was the Liggett a Coast Guard ship?
Coast Guard, old Coast Guard.
And it went over to New Zealand in 1941?
We invaded Guadalcanal in 1942. When did we, August 7th, 1942. Well, I guess you're right, that was 41 or 42.
And you ended up in Wellington first or Auckland?
Wellington. Auckland, we were only there once for a couple hours. Wellington is where we went to. Beautiful little country.
And then you went north of Wellington for picking up and dropping off soldiers?
Yeah, to the islands.
Okay, so your main job was to land...
Land troops.
For Guadalcanal and then take back wounded?
Wounded, reinforce the army.
Okay.
You're just going to take them there, leave them there with no gas for their planes or anything, you know. Food and everything. They had to bring everything up and back, you know. That's where they try to stop us from bringing supplies and all that stuff in.
So tell us, pick up on the day that you were leaving to go to Guadalcanal. What do you remember for that invasion?
Well, we were on an invasion, And I was hearing the Marines, the sergeants talking to the Marines. Remember, you guys are Marines. Fight like Marines. Kill like Marines. You just give them a pep talk, you know. And so we were on our way to Guadalcanal, and that was it.
How many ships were...
We lost one transport, we lost.
No, when you were on the way to Guadalcanal, how many ships were in your fleet?
Oh, I don't know. We had ships all over, and miles away there were ships. I was on the phones once, and I was watching the horizon. Nothing around. And here, I hear over the phones. When you're wearing the phones, you could hear the guys talking on the bridge. What was the name of that ship? Sullivan Brothers were on it. Name some cities in Alaska.
Anchorage?
What did you think I was saying? I forgot the name of the ship that they were on. Well, anyway, the ship went down. Oh, the ship went down with the five Sullivan brothers on it. Five Sullivan brothers. I can't think of the name of it. Beautiful ship. Oh, a nice awful ship. Imagine the Navy doing that, putting five brothers on one ship, the idiots.
That must have been tragic. Did you stay with your friend Alan?
With Alex?
Uh-huh.
Not after we separated, we got transferred off. But we kept in touch with cards, you know, and... What a nice kid. You ever get to love somebody? I love this guy, you know? There's nothing bad about him. He's just strictly a country boy, you know? He came from Babylon, Long Island someplace. Before the invasion of Bougainville, a submarine is on his way to Bougainville to pick up about 15 kids and two adults. And they were to pick them up on the sub, and they send from the Liggett Coast Guard, they send a guy over in a Higgins boat to pick up the kids and bring them back to the ship. It's for invasion them, invading them, and maybe the next day or so, you know. They wanted the kids to get out there. So we send over one of our guys in the Higgins boat. They could have sent me over, they could have sent anybody over. I picked these kids up. Then when we brought them back to our ship, we, you know, our guys went up nets on the side. They had these nets, but you couldn't have the kids do it. So we had to lower the steps, accommodation stairway, they call that. And all the kids had to go up, you know, they were scared walking up, you know, with water. So we helped all the kids up, we got them all up, and here comes the two adults. In the movies that I saw, it shows a priest and a nun. Yeah. They weren't a priest and a nun, they were two missionaries. They weren't in a uniform or anything. They were in civilian clothes, you know. I don't know why they changed it like that, you know. And here I am, I'm seeing two different things. I was there, you know. Where the hell these people get the... Where do you get the color? So, I mean, it's a bonus that you see, you know. They change it around and... I forgot where we took the kids. One of the islands is stuck on the off.
So, on the... Guadalcanal invasion, you had to go to and from the island quite a few times, right?
To and fro, and I had to get two guys back on my ship. I don't know, they told me, drop them off on your ship and pick up whatever they're going to send over, right? I get these two guys and they're climbing up the net on the ship. We are getting underway. You hear it over the PA system. We are getting underway. Japanese cruiser's on its way down. And they could sink everything together. The ship takes off and leaves me there. In the boat with two other guys. What a night that was. What a night that was. It started to rain and it got dark and the only lights you could see later on was the guns from Guadalcanal going off. Then you're near Tulagi, guns from Tulagi going off. Then the cruisers was fighting cruisers. I'm right in the middle. Here comes traces of this. We don't know where the hell they were coming from. Traces. This much over our head. So I tell you, we were scared, but we weren't hysterical or anything. I says to one of the guys, they wrap some life jackets around you. Maybe it'll stop a bullet. And these guys, they began laughing, you know. They weren't too worried, but these traces were coming at us, boy. Looked like big ones, too. Looked like 50 calibers, and it was a lot of fun. And all that night, we spent over there. There was planes dropping stuff on us. We didn't know what the hell, we didn't know what was going on. And that morning, the ship comes back. I finally got, I was dying for a cup of coffee, you know. I got aboard this ship, and guess what I saw? Thousands of our sailors lined up on the deck. My ship picked up all the survivors. That old lady picked up the survivors, and we found out we lost all our cruisers. The Vincent, the Quincy, the Astoria, the Canberra, which was an Australian cruiser, three-stacker. It all went down, and today they have never found the Jap there. So up until today, they think they were shooting at one another. And the only thing I remember on that ship with those guys, all in stretches, you know, on the deck, they were burnt. And you know, if you ever smell burnt skin, you'll never forget about it. For months and months, that odor was in my nostrils. All these guys were burnt, and none of them were complaining or anything, you know. Just laying there dying, you know, and what a day that was. That was Savo Island. No one knows what the hell happened. They think the Navy was shooting at one another. It was dark. I don't know if their radars were working or what, but oh, they lost a lot of guys there. Here I am in that boat all night. Oh, you know what we found in the boat? A can of sauerkraut. We couldn't open it. We had nothing. We had nothing to eat. You know, they got a sense of humor, these Americans. They're funny.
So you would go in to Guadalcanal, drop off people, and then bring back wounded?
Yeah.
And then bring back
wounded people. Or not wounded, you go back and pick up whatever they got coming over. And supplies then, or a jeep or something, you don't know.
Were you getting shot at every time you go in?
I was shot more when I was on the ship. You could hear the 5-inch shells. The guy in the hill was out of the 5-inch shell. 5-inch gun, and he was letting them go. They used to call him, the Marines call him Pistol Pete. They say he didn't have a range finder, but they used to fire that gun all the time. He used to kill Marines every once in a while. But they got him, some Ranger outfit went up there and got him. They say that he pushed out his gun on tracks, and he pushed it back in. I mean, that's what the Marines were telling us.
Were you at the Guadalcanal when the Americans took it over?
Oh yeah, we secured it.
Yeah.
We're the guys that helped secure it, but we were the guys bringing them guys to get together. One night we had a sneak in, we had a, you know, we wanted that island because of the airfield. Henderson was it? I think it was Henderson Airfield. And, that's why we wanted it. One night we had to get them high octane gears for the planes. You know, they were gasoline planes those days. And we had to sneak in there with drums of oil. We get it for the planes. You can't send a tanker in. Tanker's gonna in 2 seconds of the last, you know. And so they send us in the Coast Guard ship with all the fuel on there. And we got there, we got unloaded, and we got the hell out of there. High octane gears. You know, how any ship ever got hit? Wow. A lot of fun. When you're wearing the phones at night, guys talk to one another. This ship, they weren't strict like a lot of ships, you know. The guys on the guns would talk to one another. One guy would say, I think I ought to write my mom a letter. Dear Mom, please sell the shithouse. Your loving son is about to lose his ass. Stuff like that. You know, it was such a while. And then I was home on a 48. I got a call. A Jeep is on his way to pick me up, to take me to the barracks, to get my gear. And then I'm going to Brooklyn Navy Yard, catch a destroyer escort. And that's what was done. Got over to Brooklyn Navy Yard, went aboard the ship. I come aboard the ship, I'm wearing a hash mark, which means 4 years in the service. And this guy comes over to me, close to me, says, where you from? I says, Jersey City Barracks. Oh, you're finally going to get on a ship, he says. I says, yeah. I says, I hope I don't get seasick. He says, don't worry. He says, I'll take care of you. You like it aboard here, but I'm going to break your ass out of here, you know. I say, I'm a gunner's mate. You didn't break my ass. You're a boatswain mate. You take care of the guys that they're going to swarm to death, you know. And so on and so forth. And the next day, they have an inspection and the ship is moving. So we line up. I figured out, what the hell, let me put my ribbons on, you know. I had them in my sea bag. They were all bent over, you know. I straightened them out. I put them on. And I'm standing there, and the skipper passes. He says, when did you come aboard? I says, yesterday, he said. What was your last vessel? I says, the Hunter Lincoln. He screams out, the Hunter Lincoln. Did you know Ensign so-and-so? He named about five guys that he went to the academy with, and they kept track of one another, you know. He was a commander now, was that? And he says, oh, good to have you aboard. Then I see this guy, he was on the other line over there, you know. So he's looking at me like this to him. He felt like crap all the way, you know. Yeah, that was going on there when I left on that ship. A beautiful ship. Oh. The only thing is they got screwed when they got me aboard. These are all new guns. I'm working on World War I guns. They got all new guns. So I got to know him there for a while. But that was it on that ship. And sure enough, we go through the canal and all that. Did my playtime through it. And the war was over. So I never got over it again.
What happened with Bougainville?
Bougainville, I was in Bougainville, and I was standing watch on a gun, and all of a sudden I see six planes coming. I never saw them before. I forgot the name of the plane it was, but I knew it was an American plane. And here they had to fly over, very low. I thought they were going to go strafe the beach, you know. I said, that low to strafe it. And waited to see, and I get a message over the, I was wearing the earphones, and up on the bridge they were talking. These planes intercepted a message that one of the Japanese who were in charge of Pearl Harbor is over at Bougainville at the other end inspecting his troops. They intercepted a message. The Navy, they intercepted a message, this guy's gonna be over there. So they sent these planes after him. And sure enough, and a half hour later, these planes are passing by, and I'm still in the same position, up on the top deck, you know, and these guys are still flying low. Guess what they did when they saw me? They all dipped their wings. You know, they used to do that on patrol, we used to go out on patrol. You know, like saluting you, you know, hi. And they got the admiral who was a part of Charlie Harbor, and they intercepted that message and they went after him. Yeah, it was nice. That was in Bougainville.
Did you talk about when they rescued the Marines?
They were told that these Japs are going to surrender. So they sent these Marines over and it was a trap for them. So they asked for volunteers to try to get these guys off the island, you know. Because when we hit a beach, they transfer men. We never knew that was going to happen, you know. They transfer Coast Guard men to be with the Marines, to run these boats at night, the Higgins boats. And that's what happened. This guy went after them and he got the 36 Marines off. He saved them and he got hit in the head. And a couple other guys got wounded. But he got the Marines off. The Marines had no place to go. They were backed into water. They're going into the water, then they would be easy targets. But this Doug came in and he got them all under his boat.
You see the man that got the Medal of Honor?
Yeah, Doug Monroe, yeah. Nice kid. The only guy who ever got it.
What did you do when you got out of the service?
When I got out of the service? I was in trouble because I didn't have a trade. I didn't finish school. I had to look for any kind of a job. So I finally drove a taxi. And I finally wound up driving a truck. And that was it.
So when did you move to this place?
My family moved here when I was overseas. I didn't even know where this place was. But I found it.
So 40...
I found it.
Three?
And I came home with a Japanese rifle. And when I got a job driving a truck, a guy heard I have a Japanese rifle. Right? He begged me for it, and my wife wasn't too happy with the rifle in the house anyway. So I gave it to the guy. It was some kind of dispatcher for the trucking outfit that I worked for, Yale Transport. Mm-hmm. Then I was working in Jersey, then I had to come to New York for the New York terminal, and I was talking to him. I said, well, how do you like the rifle? He says, oh, it's good, I got $200 for it. Ah. He beat that and carried the damn thing 6,000 miles. Huh? And I told his brother about it. His brother said, what? It's two of a kind, right? Beautiful rifle, you know? I think I still have one bullet left. In the drawer. Wow. 25 caliber.
When did you get married?
January, February, I think it was March. February, I think it was.
43?
No, I came home in 44.
44.
How long were you engaged for?
I was overseas 2 years, 42 to 44. How many guys you fighting Japanese for 2 years? 2 years, invasions and air raids and...
Yeah. 50?
I'm down at
20. I don't know.
Well, listen, younger than I am, counting. Happy birthday. Oh, thank you.
Thanks so much. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, look, Josh, Linda.
Spider-Man on that.
That's a recording.
Yeah, it is a very good
one. This one to get to record.
Very nice. I like that.
Fly me to the moon and let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, darling, kiss me. Fill my heart with song and let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words, please be true. In other words, I love you.
Pavement always stayed beneath my feet before. All at once am I several stories high, knowing I'm on the street where you live. Are there lilac trees in the heart of town? Can you hear a lark in any other part of town? Does enchantment pour out of every door? No, it's just on the street where you live. And oh, the towering feeling just to know somehow you are near. The overpowering feeling that any second you may suddenly appear. People stop and stare, they don't bother me. For there's nowhere else on earth that I would rather be. Let the time go by, I won't care if I can be here on the street where you live. People stop and stare, they don't bother me. For there's nowhere else on earth that I would rather be. Let the time go by, I won't care if I can be here on the street where you live. Let me the street where you